We did it.
We did it. Mick, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Could we call you Mr. Davannis? Has that been a question you've been asked?
Yes, it has. But looking like a Norwegian, Davannis doesn't really fit.
Right.
So you can call me whatever you wish. I've been called worse. So,
what's your favorite nickname that people have for you?
Well, Mick is a nickname.
Oh, that's a good point.
My given name is Gladstone Mckinely Stenson Jr.
That is a phenomenal
All
name.
Right, Gladstone it is.
Gladstone. Wow.
Now you're thinking I'm some kind of a blue blood. Wrong. All wrong. I'm a junior. My dad was born in 1901, and he was the seventh out of eight boys, born in Starbuck, Minnesota. And I think my grandmother was running out of names, plus the fact she was a little bit of a historian at that time. William Gladstone was the president of the United States, and William Gladstone was the prime minister of England.
Okay.
And Mckinley was the president of the United States.
Gotcha. And they just went with both.
Yeah.
That's.
So I'm a junior. My mother didn't want me to be called junior, so she took Mick off of Mckinley, and I've been Mick or Mickey all my life. But I respond to anything.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I love that.
My wife has a few choice ones for me, by the way.
Nice. Yeah. That's amazing. So we read up on Davannis, and you guys have a really, really cool, rich history. I think it's really cool that you guys are first and foremost family owned and still local in Minnesota, growing and thriving. Pretty incredible stuff. So I just want to say congrats to you.
Thank you.
That's amazing. What was the original first name of it again? It starts with a P, right?
Pontillos.
Pontillos.
And we actually started in 1975 as Pontillos Pizzeria because we learned the business. When we started, I had two partners, two high school buddies. So we weren't family owned, back then. I had two other partners, and one of them was living in Cleveland, Ohio. And he met a guy who was living there. They were first married. And he got a great friendship with this guy. And the guy didn't like what he was doing, so he went back to Rochester, New York, and his father-in-law taught him the pizza business. And at that time, my good buddy was traveling up to Rochester, and he called me and he said, Mick, this pizza is fantastic. It's nothing like we've got back in the Midwest. And you've got to meet this guy. He's a great guy. So long and short of it, they ended up teaching us the business. I had another great friend from high school who wasn't doing anything at the time, had just left a job. And my partner in New York said, just find a place where they eat a lot of pizza. I don't care about the competition, just where they eat a lot of pizza. And, of course, the Cleveland and Grand Avenue location is a great area.
It's our favorite one.
That's the one we got.
You've got St. Thomas, you got McAllister, you got a wonderful neighborhood and St. Kate's and so on. So we opened there in a small spot. It wasn't that whole building. It was the second one in.
Mm-hmm.
Second building in. It was 30 seats or something like that to start out with.
And this is your first time getting into restaurant business?
First time into the restaurant business. And I was still employed as a manufacturer's rep in the plumbing business.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
It wasn't until a year later that, or about 2 years later, it was 79 actually, or 77, that we started working on our second restaurant at Riverside Avenue over by the University of Minnesota.
Nice.
And the University Hospital over there. That's our second store.
Yep.
So how old were you when you started?
28.
28?
Yeah.
So when you are going, you learn about all this great New York pizza, you're like, okay, we got to bring it to the Midwest.
Yeah.
Learning how to make New York style pizza, what is it about it that makes it different, more attractive, better tasting? How does it taste that good?
Well, I think it's dough formulation. And at that time, we only had one crust, and that was a traditional crust that they made out east. And it's hand-pounded, and it just had a nice bite to it. The family sauce that they had, the recipe for sauce they had, was distinct and really good, and it hit very well with the local people when we came here.
Right, and pizza is not really a Minnesota trait. You don't think of Minnesota, you think pizza. I'm from Chicago, and right. I mean, there are pizza places on every street.
Yeah.
When you think Chicago, you think pizza. In New York, same thing there.
Yeah.
And I appreciate how you brought their roots, and you took it to Minnesota, and then you're sitting there at 28 years old, and you're working full-time in the plumbing business as a rep,
mm-hmm.
and you open this pizza shop. That's incredible.
Mm-hmm.
When did you know that you had something where it was like, all right, it's time to let this full-time job go and go full-time with Davannis?
Well, it was when the second shot, we did so well. There was such a great reception to the first store at Cleveland Grand. We could see that it was doing well. And when we found the second location, that's when I left my other job.
Okay.
And, back in those days, we did everything. We put up paneling on the outside of the building, and, you just do what you have to do.
You're not hiring anyone, or you're trying not to hire people. You're trying to do it all yourself.
Right. Mm-hmm. Well, you're trying to do a lot of it yourself. None of the three of us that were working in the business at that time were skilled carpentry wise or whatever.
Yep.
But we follow orders well. So you had a carpenter there and they told you to do this, and
mm-hmm.
and a lot of the grunt work is what we as youngsters were good at.
Right. You're a moving and able body.
Yeah. Yes. Moving and able body is correct. Yeah.
Yeah, we just paneled this whole studio in the last 5 days. We had no idea how to do any carpentry work either.
And well done, I would say.
Hey, thanks.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is pretty awesome. But yeah. I like the mindset of you're doing it because you love to do it, and you almost have to do it. You're like, all right, we're opening a new store. We have to panel it. We have to do this. We have to do that.
Yeah.
Kind of just making those sacrifices because you love it. And at the end of the day, what are you doing, right? You're making pizzas. You're serving the greater community. So once you took it full time, was there a time where you're like, wow, this is like, was there a time where it got tough when you started out full time for the first time?
Where it got tough and what sense?
Like, maybe like a failure, just like a time where you're like, man, this is not going well, or I'm having a tough time. You got anxiety or anything like that?
In the early years, and one thing about being young is I think you're a little bit bulletproof. You kind of think
you're invincible to a sense.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And that it's not going to turn south on you. When we did change our name from Pontillo's to Davanni's, that was a time that was a little scary. It was the time when the cash flow got really, really tight. For some reason, everybody thought, oh, they got bought by some big conglomerate, and everything had changed. And we hadn't changed one thing. People were writing to us saying, your pizza doesn't taste as good as it did. Your sauce isn't as good. You're not using as much cheese. We hadn't changed one thing.
Just the name.
Yeah, just the name.
That's
all we did. And we tried to tell them that, In fact, that was one of the bylines of the advertising that we did with, there was a group that did our advertising at that time. It was called Lunch Hour Limited. It was a group of Pat Fallon, who was the Fallon McGilligot, which is a huge, Pat's passed away now, but a huge advertising company, and a couple other guys in the city that got together at lunch and took on interest in clients. And that was one of the bylines. Nothing's changed. We're all the same. And we've got some ads from one of the ones was using people like John Wayne and
Marilyn Monroe. That's awesome. Yeah.
Marilyn Monroe, and they had other names and they changed their names.
Mm-hmm. Right.
But they're the same people. And that was kind of it. So.
That's really cool.
But it was a struggle for a while.
Oh, I bet.
And you know, you just had the faith that people would see. We did increase cheese at one point because we felt, okay, let's give them more cheese if they think we don't have enough cheese or whatever.
People want cheese.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just give them the cheese.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I grew up in the restaurant business. My dad owned a restaurant from 1994 until 2002, and it was called D. Bob's. And my grandfather's name is Donald Robert. D. Bob's was the restaurant name. So I grew up in the family business. And being at the restaurant every single day, it was the coolest thing, watching my dad operate this restaurant and all the people smiling and appreciating, because he opened it in his hometown and we live two towns away, so driving over there and seeing the community rally around D-Bob's, it was the coolest thing. I want to ask you, how has it been raising a family in this business and watching now your daughter be a part of the business as much as she is today?
Well, it's, you know, I look at my teammates as partners, and, you know, you can't even believe how long I've worked with some of these people, 40 years. So they're like family.
Mm-hmm.
My president and CFO has been with us 42 years as of this coming Thursday. We just had our chief operating officer retire after 42 years.
Wow. You employed someone for 42 years, their whole career, professional
career. Their whole
career.
Mm-hmm. He left Burger King and came to work for us, and his whole career was
The rest
with
is
us.
History.
Yeah.
Wow.
So it's very gratifying to know that you provided an environment that people have appreciated, and that we've got so many teammates that have appreciated what we really stand for. You know, and that's what, when we started the business, it was, okay, let's do something where you don't always have to tell somebody to do something. Let them use their head and use their mind and make decisions. Give them some respect and trust them.
Right.
And trust goes a long way in a relationship.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's why we've had so long a tenure on so many people.
Yeah, it's very genuine, and it's awesome, like, how much you're showing you care about someone. When you, personally, when you meet someone for the first time, do you trust them right away, or do they have to earn your trust?
I think I tend to trust them until they...
break your trust.
Yeah, until they demonstrate something that I start questioning.
We are the same way. We were talking about this last night, and I'm in until I'm out with someone in an engagement, and it's like I will automatically have the most faith in that person and think they're my best friend, and I think that's the way it should be. And if they do fault you at a time, then it's time to question.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
No, I think that's very true, and you're going to find out in a period of time, not that long.
Right.
You know, so, and I think the thing that's interesting, you know, the girls have been, I've got two daughters, one that's at home today, but I think they had a different perception of what the business was than what it actually is. I think they thought it was more like The Office, the TV show, the Office, than what it actually is.
Well, we got...
I feel like
That's awesome. So what do you mean by that?
Well, you know, that there's just more weird stuff going on at the office, like the office.
Right.
And it's more sincere, trusting relationships, working together and that type of thing.
There's not those side story conspiracy type things going on.
Yeah, I could never get into that show because it looked so weird to me. I mean, I just couldn't identify with that, but I know it happens, you know.
There's definitely, they do a great job with The Office of taking like the personality of what it could be and how awkward and unique really is working in a cubicle all day. Yeah. And being in a group with 15 people and seeing them from 9 to 5 every single day, and you're working for a paper mill company.
Yeah. That is interesting. Like, there's like a cool, unique dynamic of that show, right? It goes 15 seasons, The Office, right? Something of that length.
Crazy.
The scene and the setting and what they're doing rarely ever changes. But what really happens is each character is developed. And each character kind of grows, and you learn to like love this character, but literally nothing else really changes. You like learn to love Steve Carell like 10 times more than you used to, or Jim or Pam or whoever. Mm-hmm. And it's all strictly based on the personality. Someone told us this the other day. They're like, you guys are like The Office characters because you maintain like the same personality, even though there's so much else like going on around you. There's like so much more glitz and glamour things, but regardless of whatever's your scene, you guys are just still growing as it personally, and people are getting behind that, right. Which I think is cool. And I think that goes along with like Davanni's in a sense where like you guys have just grown extremely locally from what you had built at right by St. Thomas. And now how many stores you have, like what, over 20 now?
We have 21.
21.
And we have a wholesale bakery.
Right.
And we have a coffee shop.
Coffee,
that's right.
Was that Benny? Was that there when you boys were?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that's so cool how it's all built from a local sense. I think that's just amazing.
Yeah.
What has been kind of the mindset behind that, staying in Minnesota and really growing that direction?
Well, I think it's easier to carry your theme on with people that already know you, you know, they've heard of you, than to go and open up in Denver, say, to speak or whatever.
Right.
And by the way, Denver, that's a hot spot of restaurant.
Oh yeah.
Restaurant birth.
The hoagie industry would be kind of sweet out in Denver. I think you could infiltrate.
Really? Oh, well, we'll keep that in mind.
I'll
pass that on to somebody else.
Yeah. Well, yeah, I mean, that's a good point. Like, so, I mean, you've been with the company you've grown this company for so long, and now have you taken a role where you're still as heavily involved as when you first started, or is it a little more removed, or what's your role nowadays?
Right. Yeah, I am definitely more removed. We've got people that really do the heavy lifting. Like I said, I've got a present CFO who's a St. Thomas grad. My previous COO was a St. Thomas grad. So,
Tommy Roots.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Tommy Roots. Our, one of our IT guys that has been with us for 40 years was a Tommy.
Mm-hmm.
And at any rate, I don't work as long a days. I try not to micromanage. I'm just looking across the room to see if I'm catching any stray looks with that comment. But I have a position that I have opinions and so on, you know.
So we
took on a new entrepreneurial operating system. It's called Traction.
Oh yeah, I'm familiar.
2 or 3 years ago, and it really has been a good good thing for us. I think in many ways we had a voice, and I think on the leadership level we were quite good. On some of the other levels, I think we were missing out. I'm still on the leadership level, and as a visionary, I'm the visionary in there.
Right.
And it's been a really good thing in involving, because we've always been good in involving people. I mean, we always said that you have to involve people in decision-making. Ask the people you work with in the store what the customer's thinking and so on and so forth. But this brings it really to the forefront more, I think. One of the biggest gains we've got is from the administrative people in the office. We've got some really smart people that are doing payroll and paying bills and all that kind of stuff. And
surround yourself with people that are brighter than yourself.
Yeah,
they carry out.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And they are, I think they're really, their job is more enriched. And I know that we're a better company for it. And then the store level, it's just a lot more proactive. We're getting more of a situation where the, assistant managers and whatnot are, they're more involved in getting things done. I mean, it's set down as to what you need to accomplish every week, so forth. So that's been very cool for us.
Can you explain what exactly, man, maybe this is a question for you too, Andrew, like what exactly traction is and what it does from an entrepreneurial standpoint for a company?
Well,
like what is the methodology, I guess?
I think at the crux is the communication aspect and the accountability aspect go hand in hand.
Yep. It sets up different groups, and we in our leadership group, we in the old days, we perhaps had too many people. I think it was too clumsy. There were just too many people that you're taking their time in the meetings. These meetings, these leadership meetings, last an hour and a half, no more, no less. That's what they last. And it just gets to an accountability point where if people aren't getting their stuff done, that's going to make you question whether they're in the right seat. It's called put the right people in the right seats. And there are some people that we found haven't been in the right seats, and that's got to change.
Mm-hmm. Right. Traction does a phenomenal job with the structure of their program in the sense of how the meeting starts, mm-hmm. and then like from then on is very systematic, and you're learning how to reward someone in the beginning, and then challenge them, and then at the end make sure that they know their roles. It's and I know that sounds super vague. I'm trying to remember the terms that they use so to clarify it, but I don't remember. I really when I was inside the Traction program when I worked for Media Bridge, they were just on point with what needed to get done, and mm-hmm. every single person had a smart role, mm-hmm. and I just appreciated how they ran their company.
Got it.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. Okay, wait, I wanted to go back one more time. So the when you changed the name, you were originally going to be Davanti's.
Yeah.
But, and that meant, I forget what it means in Italian. What is it?
Well, the advertising company came up with a lot of things. And one that they really liked was Davanti's, which meant the leader in Italian. And the advertising company? Yeah. Okay. The ad company came up with the names. The lawyers looked at that name and they didn't like it because Avante was a car at that time. It was made by Studebaker, Avante car. And they thought there may be some kind of a conflict there. Plus the fact that it sounded too white tablecloth. Yeah. That's when they brought it to the focus groups, the people describe the restaurant as white tablecloth, table service, and that type of thing, which didn't fit us. And then they roll the T into an N, and it's totally a fictitious name. It's nobody's name. It's nothing. It's just made up.
Mm-hmm. Well, Davanni's. You're Mr. Davanni's.
Yeah, I'm a fictitious person.
All right, we'll clip just that part out and then share that with everybody else. That's going to be perfect. We got what we needed. Perfect.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Yeah, so they...
It's edgy.
Yeah.
Davanni's is edgy. Because you can just say, Dad, Davanni's, you know, I'm going to Davanni's down the street, you know? Yeah. Something like that.
Yeah, well, they went back to the focus groups and they said, oh, you know, this is a real casual place, family owned and or family operated.
Right.
And place you take your kids to and so forth. So, and that's what it was, and we stuck with that one.
It's phenomenal.
Yeah, and finding names isn't easy. You know, I can remember when we did Coffee Bene. Oh man, you know how many coffee shops there are in the, you know, you see
too many
Starbucks and Caboos, but I mean
Caribou.
Caribou,
yeah.
Caboos. And. But there are so many local coffee shops that trying to find a great name is really hard, and it took us a long time to find one.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Coffee Ben is a good one.
Yeah. So you mentioned your first location right next to St. Thomas off what is that, Cleveland and Grand?
Yes.
Right.
And you mentioned earlier like it's a good your pizzas or your stores are great for like kids and family and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Has your college demographic been your like one of your biggest hits, or where does it rank in terms of your demographic or people that you're selling pizzas to?
Well, back, you know, the business has changed so much. Back in the day, we didn't have delivery and,
right.
and people was, I mean, we used to be open till 1 o'clock and the Tommies would be coming in there late night to try and, you know, soak up a little of whatever they're drinking. And, you know, so we had a great college group at night. That isn't so much anymore.
Sure.
You know, mm-hmm. it's more of your delivery. It's delivery is, you know, 40% of our business now. So,
wow.
You know,
is it really?
Yeah. So it's a different game.
Does that, you know? Is it a kind of a bummer from your perspective, not having the enjoyment of seeing people in the restaurant that 40% now have delivery?
Yeah. Yes, it is.
Mm-hmm.
It's, you know, and it's too bad. And our food is really so much better on premise. And when you take it right out of the oven, you have a hoagie right out of the oven. It's to die for.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's a different deal.
It's awesome.
So from that standpoint, yeah, but that's not the way we live anymore. We want the comfort of our homes.
Or our podcast studio, and we just eat it all here.
Yeah, yeah.
My first experience at Davanni's is actually pretty cool. I came up to visit St. Thomas for school and with my parents and junior in high school, and we... toured the campus, met with the football coaches and all that jazz, and then we wanted to go get food, and we just like quickly looked up food near me, and Davanni's is the main location right next to St. Thomas. Walked over there and enjoyed a nice Davanni's meal as I'm thinking about going to St. Thomas, and I do believe the reason why I ended up saying yes to St. Thomas was because I sat there at Davanni's and was enjoying a nice buffalo chicken hoagie on wheat bread.
Hmm.
And it just, it was a delight to the senses with Davanni's. And I decided St. Thomas is my school.
Mark that down to get a hold of Caruso and get all his recruits over there.
It, very similar to Andrew, actually, now that I think about it. I took a visit out to St. Thomas when I was being recruited in January on a Friday, and it was like 10 degrees when I showed up, and the first place I went was with a family friend and then one of the players on the team. We went to Davanni's. It was the first thing we did.
Right. Literally the first thing I remember having. I think it was the assorted on wheat. The assorted on wheat was phenomenal. And, you know, that's that's the bee's knees right there. I've gone back many times since. You've saved me on many Sundays after a night out on Saturday. So I want to thank you for that. That's awesome.
You're quite welcome.
It's a really full circle moment for us here.
Yeah. It is.
It's really
it
what we're realizing. Yeah. It's awesome. So what is a good story about like community or something? Like when someone says, oh, why did you start Davanni's? Why did you go through making a pizza company out in Minnesota? Is there a story or something that you refer to or tell people that represents that?
Well, I don't know if there's a particular story, but, you know, we really believed in the food. You know, you've got to have a belief in what you're doing. And mm-hmm. we thought our food and our style of service was the right thing to do, was a really good hook. And it was a business that we could have on our own. You know, we were working with other people, and we wanted our own business. So it was the food was the killer. When I tried the food right away, I fell in love with it.
Right, and then the people get behind that.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And you want to bring it back, and you know, you got to remember, 45 years ago, the competition that we had was not great. You've probably never heard of Shakey's Pizza. Well, that was a national chain back in those days, which is still hanging out somewhere in California, but certainly not thriving.
Mm-hmm. What's Tony's Pizza Company? Tony Perella's.
It's Duluth made pizza. They do like the frozen ones, right?
I think so. Do Tony, they have any store locations? We had him.
I don't know. What is it? Well, we should know this.
I know. We had him on our podcast.
Yeah.
What? No. This is bad.
Whatever. Was Carboni's around?
Ooh, Carboni's.
I believe Carboni's was around at that time.
Okay. Yeah. Now, follow-up question. I know you slice our pizza traditionally into triangles.
Yes.
What are your thoughts on cutting pizza into square slices?
Hey, we do it some. It's hard to do, though, when you cut 99% of them in slices. You can tend to automatically cut them into slices when they ask you to do it in squares. I have no problem with it.
Okay, all right.
I have no problem with it.
So 45 years ago, opening up Davanni's in the Twin Cities, what has been like your favorite thing seeing the city grow? Because that's another huge success point with Davanni's, is the Twin Cities has grown so much, and you see some awesome things going around in this area. What has been kind of like your memorable moments with the Twin Cities and being a part of it?
Well, I would say certainly the good times we've had during successes in sports back in the 80s when the Twins, you know, when the Twins were fighting for the World Series,
right.
87 and 91, we did a bunch of business with the Twins and have provided food down into the locker room and that type of thing.
That's incredible. You started this late 70s, 77, 79 is when Davanni's is starting.
75, actually.
Okay.
Yep. And 79 was the second restaurant.
Right. Gotcha. Yeah. And then in the 80s, you get inside the Twin Stadium. How, like, just rewarding in itself for you, like, knowing that the players are eating your food, your pizza. Like, that's incredible.
Yeah. I mean, and they can have what they want. So if they didn't like it, they'd throw us out.
Right.
So it was. It's very rewarding. And we were the pizza for the Minnesota Wild for a lot of years.
Mm-hmm.
We were the only pizza there and decided to pull out of that relationship. But they were great people to work with. And that we were very honored that they would choose us
mm-hmm.
to do the pizza there. So, yeah.
So I remember you had just mentioned 40% of your pizzas are now delivered, right?
Right, right.
And we're worried, not necessarily worried, but something that comes with that is that there's not necessarily people coming into your restaurants anymore, but you still want to deliver some sort of impact. So I have an idea for you, Mr. Davanni.
Okay.
Gladstone.
Gladstone. All right. Yeah. Mr. Gladstone Davanni. What are your thoughts on Andrew and I becoming Davanni's pizza delivery guys? And we go to random places and deliver Davanni's pizza to people.
I think it's awesome.
Mm-hmm. Okay, sweet.
You'd be good.
Yeah, marketing director right here.
Oh, okay. Oh, nice. Yeah. Jackie's in. Perfect.
Okay, give me a clue of where you guys would want to be delivering to.
First one would be just like a random class at St. Thomas.
Oh.
So I'd figure out like, because I mean, I was an engineer there, and I'd want to find Dr. John Abraham's class, because I know if I went showed up randomly at his class, that he would lose his shit. So that would be really fun. Mm-hmm. He would love that.
Another great idea would be showing up in one of these. We're good friends with Alter Fitness, and they run, it's like a boutique hit fitness class. Okay, so we get food involved, we get pizza involved, and you're getting a workout while you're eating pizza. I'm just seeing
pizza after the workout is what you're saying?
I'm seeing a little bit of both.
Okay.
Maybe before, maybe during.
Interesting.
And I'm just seeing I'm seeing content starting to be developed that's unique in itself where people are like, holy smokes. Yeah. We got active pizza eaters.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we could also just show up to like random houses too, but that we'd have to run that one by you, of course.
Yeah, well.
And Ben Lieber opens the door.
Yeah, right. Right,
I think this. Have you had Lieber on your show?
Yeah, we have, yes.
Oh, okay.
He is awesome.
He is a great guy.
A lot of good energy.
I love listening to him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think this has merit.
Mm.
Let's not let this die.
Okay. Where would you like to see us deliver pizza?
Mm, good question.
Yeah, that's a good question. I could think of some things, but let's let it go.
Okay. We're thinking of places just around here. We could go to, like, Denver and deliver some hoagies, too.
I see.
Be like, yeah, let me tell you about this Davanni's place. Or even, like, we can go even further. We can go, like, Thailand or something.
Maybe down to
the beach.
How about, you know, down to Lake Calhoun with, you know.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I like that. That's a good idea.
So right now we're working with this company, Embrace North, on Sunday at 1 o'clock. We go to Cedar Lake. And we get in the water, and we do a workout on the lake in the snow, and then we get in the water, and we practice embracing the north, and you totally submerge your shoulders down. We need some warm pizza after that.
There's so many times where we would need pizza.
The ideas are rolling.
The ideas are rolling. I think that's it, right?
Pizza,
hoagies, any of your guys' food, that type of food is just great to enhance community.
Yeah. And you might be able to make some new friends.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Who knows?
Right.
Yeah.
That's phenomenal.
Wow. Here we are.
And we get to share the Backpocket story all the time. And that is like our favorite thing. That's how we uplift our community is the Backpocket story. And we're built on being wildly average guys. That is our mantra. We are two ordinary average guys with an extraordinary passion to have conversations with people such as yourself. And we get to ask this question, what is your average quality? And for us, an average quality is something you do well at times and other times not so well. At the end of the day, you know, it's your hone-in, average, middle ground type quality that you're always working on. So I'd like to ask you, Gladstone, what is your average quality?
Well, you might be shocked to know that I have more than one average quality.
All right.
But let's go. Let's just go with listening can be an average quality.
Ooh.
Me sometimes.
Yeah.
The headphones help right now.
Yeah. Well, you know, I've got nothing to let my mind wander or whatever. But I think as the years have progressed, that my ability to listen has probably diminished to some degree. Well, some of it might be physical. I have worn hearing aids for about 17 years, but I do have good hearing aids, so that's more of a hearing deal.
Mm-hmm.
Listening, I can let my mind wander if I'm not. It's kind of like, get to the point here. You know what I mean? give me the cliff notes on what you're trying to tell me. In fact, we were in a leadership meeting one day, and we had a consultant come and sit in on our meeting. And he, after the meeting, he sat down with me and my daughters and Stubby, our president. And the guy said, we said, well, okay, what do you think? And he looked over at me and he said, Mick, when do you think you checked out of that meeting? And, you know, you think he's being mean about it, but he was actually right. Because there was too much stuff going on in the meeting that was like status reporting.
Mm, yeah.
That's not the way leadership meetings are supposed to be. They're supposed to have some real intriguing,
high-level, engaging type conversations.
Conversations.
Meat on the bones type stuff.
Yes.
We don't need to be pushing numbers.
Yeah. We don't need to be hearing about, okay, they're going to bring in the pepperoni at 10:15 and, you know, all that kind of stuff or whatever. So, yeah, he got me good, and that was...
So when did you check out? Pretty early?
Yeah, it was pretty early in that meeting, actually. But it drove across a point that, you know, you really gotta, you know, you gotta have something that's a little meat on the bones mm-hmm. here to keep me. And you know, I'm getting up in the years. It's like Stubby says also, you know, he says, you know, Mick is getting so old that he doesn't even buy green bananas anymore. So
it's so fortunate.
Yeah. So at any rate, I will try to say, okay, can you summarize that, or can we get to the point here, or whatever. I don't know if there's going to be a hell of a lot of improvement, boys, though.
Right.
So we need to just make the meetings more engaging for you.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. I'm cool with that.
Yeah.
We can work on that.
You know, so
we'll keep you, or just keep you out of the meetings.
Yeah, yeah. No,
we'll give
you
the cliff notes.
No. Yeah. Yeah. No, the meetings have been better too.
Okay.
Since that point in time.
Right.
Maybe build in like a quick, like 15 minutes into the meeting after you get through with talking through like 2021 pepperoni pizza sale projections. we could throw in like a visionary, like Mick awakening segment of the meeting, so to get you back dialed in, because you know, like, once we start talking about projections of pepperoni pizzas, mix out, like, and we're not saving him. He's gone. It's over. So we'll bring you back and we'll start talking about the vision of Davanni's. So that would be my next question, is what is the vision for Davanni's right now?
Well, the vision for Davanni's is to stay with what we've been doing and continue to adapt to the changes in the business.
Right.
You know, one of the big challenges we've had to deal with is third-party delivery.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas the pizza industry used to be the only
delivery option out there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Now we're competing against every other restaurant in the world, you know.
Right.
You can get food from anybody. So that's created a challenge for us. And the industry has changed to the point that people want to stay at home. We're competing against grocery stores a lot more. And it's people don't eat out as much.
Right.
So the challenge is to really keep the caliber of our stores up, the caliber of our people, and do what we do. We're trying to endeavor to remodel a number of stores. We've put bars in a number of stores.
Mm-hmm. Cleveland and Grant has one.
Little one there, yeah. We have some other ones in a number of stores that really kind of change the feeling a little bit. It's a little more inviting for single people, I think. mm-hmm. be able to come in and have a drink or sit at the bar and have a hoagie or whatever it might be.
Right.
So there's a lot of updating that we have to do on 21 stores, and that takes a lot of capital, and that's a long-term project for us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And growing up in the restaurant business, I really learned the idea of hospitality and being just offering your hand in service, that kind of mantra. Yeah. My dad loves to use this term, net promoter score. You probably use it maybe a little bit, net promoter score, which is just you ranking yourself and how well you did at welcoming in your guests and creating community. And nice. Net promoter score, our NPS. We like to use that term quite often. And that's been the coolest thing, having that mindset, making sure that you, when you come in to our studio, what is our net promoter score going to be? When we throw an event outside of this studio, what is that net promoter score going to be? What's the hospitality like? And I truly believe growing up in the restaurant business with my dad and watching that happen has allowed me to look at others in a more holistic way and welcoming them, because I've seen my dad time and time again change his attitude and make sure that when a family comes in, he has no idea how their day has been, whether they had one of the best days in the world or the worst days in the world. Mm-hmm. But he has the opportunity right then and there to light them up in the most positive way. And he has shared that with me and my two brothers and instilled that kind of mindset. And I think it's the coolest thing that I was able to be a part of that.
That is really, you're so right on with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm sure he tried to get to know his regular customers as much as he could.
Right.
Know them by first name or whatever. Make them feel welcome.
Mm-hmm. And that's what's in his back pocket. You know, he uses those attributes, those habits. And when pressure becomes stress, he makes sure that he's welcoming others. He has that hospitality mindset all the time in his back pocket. So, Mick, I'd like to ask you, what is in your back pocket when pressure's rising and you have a lot of stress? What is something that you utilize in your back pocket to overcome these situations?
Well, you know, my nature is that I'm more of a calm person. I don't fly off the handle. You get a lot of bad news through the years, and 40 years I've had a lot of bad news. And you just got to take a step back, take a deep breath, know that not everything is bad that's running through your mind is going to happen. And when things are really, really good, they're probably not going to be that good forever. So you got to keep that in mind too. But I'm calm. I take a step back. I have the confidence that we're going to sit and we're going to analyze this problem and we're going to get through it. You've got a team of people that you work with and you trust them and you're going to figure it out. So, and then, you know, you go home at the end of the day, you give your wife a hug and your dog a hug and maybe a glass of brandy and a cigar, that might help too.
Amen to that.
Yeah.
Yes, sir. You know, I love that.
Mm-hmm. What kind of dog do you have?
A King Charles Spaniel. Cavalier King Charles Spaniel. Good, good lap dog.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We used to have bigger dogs, but we've migrated down into
downsized to that.
Yeah.
I love that.
So
your back pocket answer, or what's in your back pocket, sounds like you stay cool, calm, and collected, but you remain confident in your ability and honestly remaining grateful as well.
Right. And quit trying to look at the glass half full, you know, or half empty.
Half empty, right. Yeah, I was going to say. Yeah, half full is kind of nice.
Right. I like what's happening.
All right, so we'll clip that out too.
Yeah.
Just quit looking at the glass half full.
Oh, beautiful.
As he's drinking his half full.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, is that glass half full or half empty?
I would say it's half full.
There we go.
There we go.
I like that a lot. I love that.
And that's marketing.
Yeah. And that's it. Now, next question for us. So how we grow this podcast in the Twin Cities is through a challenge question and a connection through the guests we have on the show. So I'd like to ask you,
who do you think we should have on the show from your network, or who do you think we should have on the show?
Somebody that would be interesting, I assume.
Everyone's interesting. That's the best part. Everyone has a story, and but that's our, and it's our job to make sure the story is is well spoken.
But if they're super interesting, then yeah, we want that person for sure.
Well, you know, last night I ran into my favorite weather person in the Twin Cities, Belinda Jensen.
Okay.
All right.
And I think she would be a wonderful addition to this podcast. She is, if you've ever watched her on Care 11, and she has a morning show on Saturday morning, she is as nice and genuine as anybody I know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm telling you, she is absolutely terrific.
Challenge accepted.
She's got, you know, her experience is over, I think she's been at Care 11 25 years. I'm not sure, but I think so. And so she'd have a lot of things to recount, plus the fact that she's an entrepreneur and trying to, she's writing books, and they're on the weather, trying to get kids interested in the weather. So I think she'd be a wonderful one. You guys would like her, and she'd like you too.
Okay.
All right. Yeah. Belinda, I love that name, by the way.
Mm-hmm.
Such a big fan of the name Belinda.
Yeah, no, she's just a terrific gal. I liked her from the, you know, I always liked her. We used to watch her Saturday morning show, and I'd make pancakes every Saturday morning for the girls.
There it is.
You know, and we'd be watching Belinda with her Saturday morning show, and then, you know, 15 years later or so, one of my buddy's daughter ends up being a great friend of hers, and I meet her, and we hit it off like crazy. She's just a nice person.
Were you starstruck the first time you met her? You're like...
I was, and in fact, I made some comment to that effect, and I felt stupid about that the next day. You know, but no, she's just as genuine a gal as there can be.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
The next question we'd like to ask you, we're going to open up to our man over here, producer
on the
Ty,
throne.
On the throne.
Real quick, Ty, how are you feeling over there?
I have a lot going on over here. It's a little overwhelming. I don't know how it sounds on YouTube. Like, we could be, nobody could hear anything right now. I have no idea.
Allegedly.
Oh, we'll figure it out.
That's
after.
Horrible.
Don't
news.
Worry. Don't worry. It's not like it's an audio program or anything. It'll be fine.
Well, this man got a promotion most recently, so I'd like to
voice that
on the podcast. He's no longer intern Ty, he's producer Ty.
Yeah.
He's a full-time employee.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you. I worked really hard. My mom's super proud of me.
Yes. And he also asks phenomenal questions, so I'd like to open up the floor to him.
So I was curious, Davanni's is obviously a family-run business. What are some of the, give me like the best part about working with your daughters, and maybe the worst part, or the part that is like, this is tough because I have to work with my family. Because I know my family and I couldn't work with them.
Yeah. You know, I have an amazing way to get along with people. That's kind of my deal. In fact, her sister has been living at our house for the last 3 months because she's getting her house remodeled. So working with them and only seeing them
day to day, you know, every so often,
8 hours a day or, you know, here and then, that's kind of a piece of cake. Having to live with them, there's a challenge when they're in their 30s, you know. It's been a wonderful deal for me to be able to spend time with my girls and to see them grow and see the business and start picking up and seeing things that I've been talking about for a long time. Oh, as far as hard parts, the hard parts of working with them is, you know, they don't let me get away with anything. They really call me on the carpet in front of my coworkers too. So,
sure.
You know, it's brutal honesty. Dad, don't do that. you know.
Yeah.
That type of thing, you know. So maybe I'm learning some better manners than if they hadn't been around.
Right.
Sounds like accountability is at an all-time high at Davanni's Corp.
Yes, there is.
Only
yes,
honesty.
Only honesty. Yeah. Yeah. Brutal honesty.
Yeah.
That's I love right. that. Right. Great question, Ty.
Thank you.
You killed it, man.
I'm paid now, so I have to step it up.
Yeah. Right.
There's no more slacking.
Right. Yeah. That's the occasion. Yeah. And you have risen.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That's great.
Mm-hmm. Just understand, if this audio is bad, your fault, right?
I don't want to like go on and take the blame for it.
No, I'm just kidding.
Okay.
You're killing it, man. I like that chair, too. The Viggo Mortensen Lord of the Rings chair.
Yeah.
Is that treating you well?
Well, it's a little uncomfortable. It's just a wooden chair.
Correct.
But
correct. We used to make our guests sit in that chair.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah.
We've
yeah.
changed over
We've
the
changed.
Times.
Yeah. We graduated to a couch.
Maybe that's we'll fun. Get you a throw pillow.
That'd be nice.
Ooh, you like something comfortable to sit on.
Yeah, a little something for my rump.
Right. We can get that done.
We can cool. work that out.
I also would love a camera on me.
Maybe when you get another promotion. To
yeah.
There you go.
Something else.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Right. I like that. Mm-hmm. Perfect.
Cool.
Okay, final question?
Well, I do want to ask a little bit of Minnesota sports.
Oh,
so
yeah,
we were just
yeah.
talking off air with the Gophers and how you were at the Rose Bowl in 1960.
Yes.
That is one of the coolest stories. Your mom took you there.
Yep.
And they have not been back since 61, so the year after.
Right.
But we're going to make an early projection. They're going to be at the Rose Bowl this year.
If they're at the Rose Bowl, I'm going to be there.
Yes.
Let's go.
I will be there. I'm leaving that open.
So. Okay, and I want to pitch you on another idea real quick.
Okay.
If you're at the Rose Bowl, that is killer content. Gladstone Davanni's at the Rose Bowl. That yep. is marketing 101. You need to capture that. Yeah. We'd love to follow you around and capture you in that moment, and we can hand out Davanni's pizzas as we walk into the Rose Bowl and cheer on the Gophers to a victory. Over, I'm guessing, Oregon.
Well, you know, we'll be still on our 45th anniversary mm-hmm. during that time, so maybe we can do something with it.
Yes. Know?
We're going to be doing promotions throughout the year, so maybe we'll figure out something at the Rose Bowl to do.
There we go.
And maybe I can send it back for the podcast.
Yes.
You know.
Mm-hmm. Yes. I'm sensing a lot of good sports.
Oh, yes.
I'm sensing a lot of good sports with the Minnesota this year. I think the Davannis and sports are going to be going hand in hand. There's going to be a lot of growth in both areas.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you guys like football. I know you played football. So, mm-hmm.
Yes.
So.
Yeah, we're all over it.
Mm-hmm.
Pizza and football. That's
how about the Vikings?
So the Vikings, on the other hand, you got to do something about Kirk Cousins.
Uh-oh.
Yeah. He's got to come on the podcast. We got to sit him down.
We got to talk him through some stuff.
Mr. Worldwide.
This offseason. We gotta get Rudolph on too. We just gotta hit our benchmarks, you know. Get a couple of players on, so now we're vested. We know that our influence is hopefully making an impact for the upcoming season.
Right.
And then Davanni just sees wins off that, anyways.
Right. We were told if we have Kirk Cousins on, we will go global.
Yeah. Someone told us that one time on the podcast.
Yeah.
Jackie knows Rudolph.
Okay.
But the problem is that those guys get pretty expensive for their time. I don't know.
Right.
We'll figure it out.
Can't you get Lieber or?
Greenway.
We had Greenway. I listened to part of Greenway.
Yeah, both of those guys are awesome.
Yeah.
It's total studs.
Yeah, they're just real people, I think.
Absolutely.
Right.
Yeah. And that was the coolest thing, having a conversation with both of them.
Mm. Yeah. You know, when I went to that Rose Bowl 1960, and, you know, being a 12-year-old at that time, there are certain things you remember that you carry with you throughout your life. And I remember we were on an airplane where there were a group of people from Minnesota, and we kind of got to know some of them. And I remember Kurt Carlson asked us to join his group for dinner. Kurt Carlson was the Carlson Companies, built the Carlson Companies, and he was a big-time guy. I mean, really big. And
Carlson Business School.
Yeah,
and
Carlson Business School, mm-hmm. U of M, yeah. And we went to a Polynesian place or something. I remember that. It was very cool to me. I'd never been to one of those. So, you know, that was it. Then another thing that I remember was staying in a hotel, which wasn't the most luxurious hotel that we were staying in, by the way. But they had a water shortage. for some reason, or the water got shut off in the place, and we had to use water out of the back of the tank of the toilet to brush our teeth.
Wow.
I mean, these are random things, guys.
But, yeah. but you're 12.
These have stuck with me for
forever.
All these
since
years.
You were 12. Yeah. That's a travesty.
Yeah. And I do remember at that time watching television and watching Arnold Palmer win a big golf tournament, too.
Nice.
Yeah. The king.
The king.
The Arnie. King. That's crazy. You can just remember stuff like that out of nowhere.
Mm-hmm. Like, that's what stuck with you.
Yeah, when you're my age, you'll probably remember a few things like that, too.
Mm-hmm. I have a question about that. So we're 23, 24.
Yeah.
Do you have any advice for guys like us or people that are in their 20s? Like, if you could say one thing to this generation of people, what would that be?
Yeah, live your dream, you know. Do something you really enjoy, and someday it's going to turn out. It's going to work, and then you got to work real hard. You got to give it your all. I don't think that's anything novel, but be sincere and honest. And I think you guys have, you're greatly underestimated as being moderate people or middle.
Average, ordinary average guys.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're way above that. Both of you guys are way above that.
Well, we do have.
So your billing is a little misleading, but that's all right. You know.
Well, we're all above average in our own ways, right?
Yeah.
But at the same time, we can all sit down and relate over the fact that, you know, we're not very good at listening sometimes.
Yeah. You know? No kidding.
Mm-hmm. So we're all average in some sense.
Right.
No one's really not average.
That's
if you think about it.
Yeah, that's true.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, thanks. I guess we are above average. I'll say it.
We'll take it.
We'll take it. Thank you.
We're having a good time.
Yeah, absolutely. I appreciate that.
I want you to have good self-images as you go forward in life.
Of course. That's phenomenal. But I think this wraps it up to our final question.
Final question.
Simple question. What did you learn today from the moment that you woke up to when you were walking up to this third floor of our studio, our newly created studio? What did you learn today?
Well, I learned that, first of all, that you were obviously better than average.
Thank you.
And you were much easier to get along with than I thought you might be.
Yes.
Awesome.
You were very intimidating?
No, not at all. Sweet. You were very welcoming. And it was very enjoyable sitting down and talking to you.
That's awesome.
That's great. I'm imagining, like, your daughter's coming up and be like, hey, Mick, you got booked on a podcast on Saturday. Are you in?
No. No.
There's these two 23-year-old guys and we're going to go over to their house. You know, I can see how you're like, oh, man, thanks for the opportunity. No way.
To be honest with you, I was like, say what?
Yeah.
But it turned out great. I'm happy I did it.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Thank you so much. Jim. We appreciate your time.
Good luck to you guys.
Thank you.
That's down on the back pocket.
It's a wrap.
Just a step away from everything she said.